Hi everyone, welcome back. I'm Melanie and this is CNM Glass. And right now we're talking about our second part of Learning Module 3 for 2030, Labs and Paths. Okay, so laboratory and pathology coding. We'll be looking at panels, some definitions here, and also surgical pathology, as well as a scatter of modifiers. So let's start with looking at paneling. In our pathology and laboratory section, the first code that we come to is 80047, which is our basic metabolic panel with calcium ionized. You'll notice that under the panel codes, which are your first two pages of your laboratory section, each of these has a series of different tests that are done as part of that panel. And so what they're doing is they're looking at calcium, carbon dioxide, chloride, glucose. They're looking at all the different things that are found in your blood chemistry to see exactly what are the levels that you're at and whether or not something's missing or having absorption issues. This identifies a lot of diagnostics for providers and gives them a good idea of where we're at. In fact, most of you have had blood work done in the past and are somewhat familiar with some of these tests. When we're coding for panels, it's important to identify with whether or not the insurance has a specific guideline of three or more tests makes it a panel. So sometimes you'll have a panel such as 80047, and the insurance says, if you have three or more of this, we only will pay the panel code, not the individual codes that are listed. So 82330, for example, is listed for calcium that is ionized. It's also important to identify that you can't bill another panel that includes what is already been billed. So if I'm looking at 80053 for a comprehensive metabolic panel and 80047 for a basic metabolic panel, it's important to identify, according to the guidelines, which one of these has more of the services that you're billing and to bill the higher one in the instance where you're billing more than the previous panel. Okay, so that can get a little bit confusing. The important thing is when you're looking at any blood chemistry test, look at your panels first. If you're not billing insurance specific, you have to meet all of the codes that are listed in that panel to bill that charge. If you only have one or two additional chemistries beyond what's in here, what you would do is you would bill this panel here that includes all of these tests plus the individual codes for the additional chemistries. So, in the instance that I had 80047, which included calcium, carbon dioxide, chloride, creatine, glucose, potassium, sodium, and urea nitrogen, and let's say that I also happen to have a test for complete blood count while I was at it. I would look to see if any of these tests included a CBC, complete blood count, and if it did not, have all of this together with a complete blood count as a comprehensive test, I'm going to add that on my own to bill the blood count separately in addition to the panel. Okay, so it's important to look through these when you're looking at any chemistry labs. That's your first and most important thing about laboratory testing. Our next question though, let's look a little bit into drug testing. We've all been there where we've gone and we're excited for a new job and they come in and they say, okay, did you eat any lemon poppy seed muffins before this test? Because you may test positive if so. And a lot of people say, oh no, well, I did have that one lemon cake a couple of weeks ago. Not to worry, there's a difference now if they choose to do the test. There is a difference between quantitative and qualitative. Let's look at that for a moment while I clear off the board. A quantitative test is the quantity, whereas a qualitative test is the quality. Think about those terms for a moment. We've all heard the term that it's better to have a quality, let's say a chocolate cake. It's better to have a good quality chocolate cake than it is to have a lot of chocolate cake that maybe isn't so good. The same concept applies here. If you think of the terms quantitative and qualitative, then we can say quantity, how much, and quality. Does it exist? Okay. So if it exists, if it's a qualitative test, we're testing to see, is this particular item that we're testing for present in the sample that we have? So if it's a blood test and we're looking for a specific blood, or a urine test and we're looking for a specific item in the urine, we're looking to see, is it there? Okay, so this is what most of your drug testing will be based off of. The next one is the quantity. How much of it is there? Oftentimes this will be done, especially with drug testing, and they have presumptive and definitive test class here. And if we look over at some of our drug tests here, you have presumptive, any number of drug tests, any number of devices or procedures capable of being read by direct optical observation only, whereas definitive drug test provides the drug classes, associated CPT codes, and drugs included in each class. Okay, so when we're looking at that, you need to ask yourself, when they're looking at presumptive, are they presuming that it's there? And that is part of the quality or qualitative, does it exist? And we're presuming that it's either there or it's not there. Whereas definitive drug testing, how much of it is there? What specifically is there? Okay, so in the instance where you go in and you're looking for a new job and you tested positive because of that so yummy lemon poppy seed muffin, make sure that you ask them, hey, can we also do a quantitative, because I did have that muffin and I want to make sure that I don't test as if I had done something else. Okay, so quantitative versus qualitative. When you're looking at your numbers, if you have a lab test and you have results, for opiates, for example, and the results say yes or no, what kind of test am I looking at? That's a yes or no question, is saying, does it exist? So that is a qualitative test. However, if I'm saying 0.0125 as the amount, that is a quantitative test. And that's telling us how much. So how many of this drug is found in the blood per however they're testing. And each one of these is a little different as to what they're testing against. You'll also see ranges listed within all of your drug testing and all of your chemistry testing that says average, abnormal, not abnormal. And that's going to help you with diagnostic coding as well as with CPT. Okay. So let's say we have panels down. We look at quantitative versus qualitative in the blood and molecular testing. Immunology looks at the same thing. So do you have, like, say, a specific antigen that is says you have immunity to something that's called a titer? They'll go in and they're looking to see if you have already had your flu shot. Are you immune to it? Or if you've already had your Gardasil for some individuals, and are you immune to the HPV virus? So those kind of tests will tell us immunity to something. And then we get into the really nitty gritty, which is your surgical pathology. Okay, so pathology and lab abbreviations, pay attention to those in your book. It's very useful. One of the things that you want to start with on your pathology, surgical pathology, section 27.8, there's a couple of different levels, and it starts with code 88300, which I'm going to turn here in my CPT book. I wanted to point out this because your surgical pathology has levels 1 through 6, and these are really important in identifying exactly what type of specimen was sent to the pathologist, what kind of exam we did. And it gets actually really specific on some of them. So it's very important we look at this. Now, my level 1 is my gross exam. And when you think of the term gross, I always say, think of what does it look like? Well, any kind of bloody tissue to me sounds a little gross. So if I'm looking at And that's all that's documented is an observation of the specimen itself that is considered a gross exam. So it is just an eye visual. Okay? And so if we do a gross examination only, no matter what it is, no matter where it's from, that is a level one. And they use Roman numerals here. After that, you have levels 2 through 6. And this is all going to be, let's see, we'll do 2 through 6. Okay. And this is all going to be with both gross and microscopic. And this is where the provider is taking, the pathologist is taking whatever the sample is, they put it on a slide, they may cut it up into pieces so that they can look at it very specifically under the microscope at a cellular level and tell you exactly, is this cancer cells? Is this normal? Is this uncertain? What's going on with the sample that was sent to them today? So the first information you want to identify with surgical pathology is what type of exam it was. And then once you've identified if it's a microscopic exam, which most of them are, you need to identify, does this fall under levels 2 through 6? How is that identified? Well, it has a list of all the different things over the next couple of pages for each of those levels. There are some, however, that you want to be cautious about, okay? So anything pertaining to the skin is one of those big ones where you have to say what part of the skin, what specifically are we looking at, okay? The first one you'll see for 88302 level 2 is going to be skin plastic repair. So if I have a sample of the skin and it's not plastic repair, I want to keep going, it may be coded somewhere else. Under level 3, you're going to find skin cyst tag and debridement, or soft tissue debridement, or soft tissue lipomas. Okay, so there's three different ones there that you want to be aware of. Soft tissues are underneath the top layer of the skin, so you want to think about everything that goes into soft tissues and connective tissues here. Okay, if we go to level 4, so that was level 3, if we go to level 4, under the skin, we have skin other than cyst tag debridement or plastic repair. So that kind of makes sense because we had those previously. Okay, soft tissues other than tumor, mass, lipoma, or debridement. Now we've seen some of those, but not all of them. So it's really important, even though the provider may have called it skin, that you look at all of these to look at the pathologist's definition before determining your correct code. Okay? That's a level 4. A level 5 goes further on to say soft tissue mass, except for lipomas, biopsy or simple excision. Okay, so a soft tissue mass, something just under the skin that's not a lipoma, biopsy, or a simple excision. And then your level 6, you have also soft tissue tumor, extensive resection. Okay, so they have an extensive resection where they've removed this and they're looking at it. So any of those codes, when you're coding for surgical pathology, make sure you read all of the different categories before settling in on your final one. Okay. So if you have questions on these throughout the week, feel free to send me a message. Remember that we have a hard due date in this chapter at the end of section 1, so you have a little bit of time to do some of the homework questions. Make sure you go through all of your readings before taking your exam and practicing along with the homework online as well. The last thing I wanted to talk to you guys before we're done today is a little bit on modifiers. This is just a scatter, and there's a couple of them that are really important here. Number 1, if you have a repeat procedure, okay, so modifiers 76 and 77, repeat procedure or service, this applies to your labs, 76 verses 77 would apply. This is going to be where you have a 76 is a necessary for reporting a repeat procedure done by the same physician or other healthcare qualified healthcare professional, whereas a repeat procedure for 77 is done by another physician. So 76, the way this works is same lab, it's considered the same doctor. No matter who did it, if it's the same lab, same billing, it's the same doctor. 77 is the same day, but different lab, different doctor. And this is really important because I've seen it where patients have a lab test done, especially if they're inpatient and maybe they were outpatient earlier on the same day, or if they went from the ER to the from the urgent care to the ER and they had repeat testing. Any of these things can happen and cause denial. So these modifiers are meant to help you identify that those services were repeated on the same day. Okay, you have a couple of modifiers in the 90s. So if it is a diagnostic and it's repeat, it's the same concept. 91 is a repeat clinical diagnostic lab test. Okay, 92 is alternative. Okay. Alternative meaning we didn't like the results from the other one. It wasn't exactly definitive, and so we're going to do an alternative test, or we're doing this as an alternative to what's usual and customary. Okay, and let's see, we skipped over 90. Let me go back there. A reference or outside lab, and this is a billing information. This is if your doctor's office is billing for the laboratory. They're not connected, but they're billing for it because they sent it off and it's all on one bill. The lab sends the bill to the doctor's office and the doctor sends the bill for the lab along with their regular services and modifier 90 to say, we didn't perform it. We were billed it because we ordered it and here's the charge for it. So those are some of your modifiers there. What's the difference between a 91 and a 76 or 77? Again, you want to keep in mind that difference between a repeat diagnostic test versus a repeat lab test. So if they're going in for diagnostic purposes versus if they're confirming report of services, there's something that they don't agree with on the test or it seemed a little odd. The difference is the key word being diagnostic. Okay, your last one that I wanted to show to you today is QW, and this is for CLIA wave test. Now, anytime that you are in a doctor's office who performs the lab test themselves, it's going to be considered a CLIA wave test if it's billable out of the office. So they're not sending you out for labs. It's not a separate lab office inside the doctor's office, but the doctor performing the test is the actual physician ordering it. In that case, in an outpatient setting for a doctor's office, family practice, or internal medicine, they can only do specific CLIA wave tests, and every time that they're going to bill one of those, you'll put a QW. How do you know if a test is CLIA waived? Well, there's a PDF online that you can pull up every year that lists all the codes that fall under CLIA waived. That's it for today. I'll give you guys some of those resources later on for CLIA wave tests and identifying modifiers. Feel free to let me know if you have any questions, and we'll talk to you next week.